home was never like this. Thank goodness. Oh, dear. We have so much fun here. Now, like last night, somebody brought a little 9-year-old boy in here. What he left to is 38. In fact, I went with him. Are you ready for the new look? This is it. You think I'm kidding? It's a cross between Jackie Kennedy and Camelot. I haven't had a single drink and my dress is stiff. Do you know that I'm the only woman in the world who gets dresses rejected by the Salvation Army? They send them back with ugly notes. You know, with things like, Dear Phyllis Diller, this dress could wreck a girl's life. Well, depending where she wears it. Oh, seriously, I've got a tinsmith inside repairing it. That's the small one, and, it came with a lightning rod right here. But I was getting a couple of channels I couldn't stand. I want to explain why I'm here, because I know you're going to wonder sooner or later. My explanation involves the management. I'm going to have to talk quite a bit about them. So we'll save a little time. I'm going to speak from now on of the management simply as they. And remember, it's just another four-letter word. They invited me here in hopes I might be able to bring up the tone of the play. Now you know we're never going to get it up to street level. You know, if they put down a new rug, they think they've done their part. That raises a half an inch, you know. And they didn't do it right. They just slapped it down over everything. And there's some big lumps that I know are people. And there are some little teeny lumps that are still moving. But if there is a low-budget way to do it, they'll find it. Like the year the sanitation board sent a man in here. Holy smoke, when he regained consciousness. Well, he saw it by daylight, sweetie. He said, look, you have got to get an exterminator in here. Do you know what they did? Hired a Spanish dancer. One red-hot tip for every lady in this room, I personally wouldn't think of going into that powder room. But I dropped in opening night to read the walls. One of the waiters thinks I stole an altar piece. I'm in enough trouble without getting mixed up with them. Incidentally, watch out for that waiter. He's very nervous. You'd be nervous too if you were stealing. And our back bartender there, he looks very honest, but he was treated last week for hand in the till. That's a terrible disease. We have a great new drink here that opens your nose. But it closes one eye. But where was I? Oh, yes. Oh, I just hope you didn't eat here. If I could have just warned you, you know. Of course, you know, they're so proud of the food. Just because it's never been touched by human hands. The chef is an ape. Oh, I knew it the minute I met him. Well, he made a pass at me. And they work a little different. Holy smoke, you talk about direct. candlelight, no wine, just boom. I could never go for him. Oh, peanuts on his breath. And... and he's just a little hairy. But beautifully marked. Wears a full-length net, you know. It's I think it's the one they caught him in. And I'm already at work on my next book. You're not going to believe what it's about. Old age. I'll tell you what, I've made a personal decision about it. I'm not going to fight it. I'll tell you why. I'm a very poor loser. And I've never seen a winner. Oh, I've been watching Mother. Oh, she doesn't know the fight's over. And it's very embarrassing when you and your mother are both approaching the same age from opposite directions. Oh, dear. You know, I'm so serious about this old age bit that I want to tell you, I have a goal, and I would really love to live to be 100. That's one of my goals, and I'll tell you why. I don't think they expect so damn much of you at that age. Start bossing you around, I bet you can look them right in the eye and say, I'm poop. And if I make it, I've got a plan. I know exactly how I'm going to play it. I'm going to be a sweet, innocent, little, white-haired old lady with a cane full of gin. And I have a very good chance of making it. My grandfather is 105. Of course, he's been dead for 20. And he's still at the head of the table. Well, we can hardly eat. You know, nothing will kill a meal like one person not enjoying it. One line in a will, and there he sits. And we got 20 years to go. That's a lot of eating out. I couldn't tell you how many women I know. I have this one very elderly woman friend who has had that face lifted so many times. There is nothing in her shoes. She wears a dog collar to cover up her navel. And there are a lot of other problems you would never think about. I guess you thought about it. Well, for one thing, she's had this done so many times that she can't ever stop smiling. She's a mess at a funeral. Now, I think it is perfectly great when women try to stay pulled together as long as possible. And by that, I mean, you know, you go to the beauty parlor and the expensive salon. Boy, you know, it bothered me for years. Why do you pay so much more to salon than you do in a chink beauty parlor? Because I know it all comes out of the same bottle. In fact, my picture's on it. So I researched it, and I can tell you exactly what you're paying for. You're paying for the way you are treated as a person. Now, you go into a chink beauty parlor. And some ugly brawn at the desk who hasn't blown her nose in 20 years will insult you. I got into one by mistake, and this girl said, well, lady, we do repairs, not reclamation. You know, I am not really wrinkled. I just had a nap on a chenille spread. Now, it's just the opposite at an expensive salon. You are treated like a lady, regardless. The minute you walk in there, a gentleman greets you properly. He bows from the waist and he says, madame, and you've never been in business in your life. But I know exactly where the trouble spot is. Here, it's middle age. And here's what happens. A woman hits 40, going 90 miles an hour. And boy, that's a crack up. One morning, she gets up, she looks in the mirror, she punches the panic button. She says, I gotta be younger by lunch. And she'll go through a whole list of idiotic ideas like renting smaller children. But 9 out of 10 will rush off to a plastic surgeon. Or go under the knife, as we say at the clinic. And are you ready for the big fallacy? They all expect to come out looking like Tinkerbell. So what if you do? What are you going to do about the rest of it? Gravity's been pulling on it for 40 years. And I hate that word gravity. It reminds me of a little personal tragedy. 2 weeks ago, my Playtex living bra died. Of starvation. I mean, if just once I could throw up my arms and say, my cup runneth over. So many people think maybe I'm kidding about that surgery, but I'm very much against surgery. Well, I'll tell you what, I have a friend who had it. And I mean had it. You wouldn't have believed this job. I've known this girl ever since we were the same age. And I didn't recognize her. Now, that's how bad the job was. But she came up to me on the street. She says, hello, Phyllis. She said, I have found this perfectly divine. She can't talk very well. I found this divine new plastic surgeon. I said, well, I don't know how divine he is, but I'm sure he's new. And she said, well, I just love him. I think he's marvelous. And he works very cheap. I said, I can tell you something else about him. He's left-handed. Oh, we went to lunch. I couldn't eat. You are not going to believe what happens when she chews. Nothing hits. And she's got food all down the side. We moved 3 times. The table kept filling up. Oh, she's got a nasty leak right here. And when she whistles for a cab, her hair goes up. I watched her bite off an earring. From another woman. But deep inside, she knows she's in trouble. It all spilled out over dessert. She says, Phyllis, do you think this might hurt my career? I couldn't think of a single career it wouldn't hurt. I said, well, what do you do? She says, I'm a lipstick model. Well, I tell you, I want to tell you a little more about this poor girl with this. That's a sad case. And I'm involved because, well, look, any lipstick model in this shape is in trouble. Because, you see, right, here's what gets me. Right now, lipstick is the biggest thing in the fashion picture. You know that, darling. Well, yeah, the new pale look, face it. You look like you just might be passing on. Oh, the first time I wore it, I was followed by a mortician. But you know what really bothered me? The vultures. Because they know. And on top of that, I suffered a couple of direct hits. In fact, that's why I gave up saving. I couldn't get past the pigeons at the bank. They used to wait for me. Here she comes, fire one. It was either close the account or marry a cleaner. No, really, I was so shook up by that mortician. Well, I'll tell you, I had the vultures and the whole thing, and then he had gone back for his bag. So I sneaked into my doctor's office for a little bit of a checky uppy pie poo. And my doctor panicked. He thought I was passing on. But you know why he panicked? He thought I was going to do it in his office. They hate that. One stiff will empty a waiting room. But in closing, I want to tell you about a fabulous new product that I'm frankly touting. I'm a great believer in cosmetics. In fact, let me tell you how much of a believer. I'm a midget. I believe it, you know. When I wash what I wear off at night and go to bed, I put a drape over that glass in the mirror. Bathroom. Mirror in the bed. You know what I mean. And when I get up in the morning, I take peeks. That's the way I play. You know what keeps me humble? Mirrors. That's right. And I want to tell you about the world's most fabulous new cosmetic. It's a new odor under dearmament. And the name of it is and of course backwards that's it is so great. It works on an entirely different principle. Doesn't kill the odor at all. Just makes you invisible and nobody can figure out who smells. Because I have always felt that in every evening there should be one moment of truth, and I think that's plenty. And tonight, our moment of truth concerns this. I'm going to tell you the whole truth. This is my stove. Isn't that pitiful? How unsuccessful can a girl look? And everybody thinks I'm wearing anchovies. And the worst of it is I trapped these under my own sink. And I will never forget the way it happened. This one up here was running very, very fast. And he stopped suddenly. And this one was following too close. And that's your driving lesson for today. And I shouldn't be giving a driving lesson. I admit that. I get on a terrible record. See, when a woman first learns to drive, you're pretty safe in your own neighborhood because you call them up and tell them you're coming. But it's when you go downtown for the first time that you're really on your own. And oh boy, everything went wrong, and it really wasn't my fault. Really, it was my husband's fault, things that happened to me. Although he was not along. He had put the car in the garage backwards. Well, that shot the hell out of my map. And boy, I went right out the wrong end. And that put me on the wrong street, going the wrong way on a one-way street that wasn't going my way. And boy, they're organized. They won't give an inch. And everybody is coming this way except me and one other woman. I loved her. She was following me. because she was dragging sections of a fence. And I still had quite a bit of the garage on me. And people were yelling pretty nasty things. One man said, "Lady, ought to have your license taken away." I said, "I haven't got one." And at the first stop sign, she and I became very close friends. And we discussed what to do, and I suggested that if we would both back up, they wouldn't notice. Well, there's one thing wrong with it. You're facing them for blocks. You know, how long can you blow kisses and drive? But yeah, it worked for her. She backed around the corner and I backed over an officer's motorcycle. Oh, are those guys temperamental? You'd have thought he owned the damn thing. Well, he was on it. But he was in a terrible mood before I ever came along. I think he must have had his badge pinned to his skin. Because I couldn't have treated him nicer, I jumped out of the car immediately. I offered to help him put his gun back together. But I don't care how sweet you are to those guys, you're gonna get a ticket. He didn't write it, his arms. Oh, Lord. Both of us. Oh, but I do have one red-hot driving tip for every woman in this world. Now, whenever you have to call home after one of these little incidents, never start out one of those conversations with, "Guess what?" Because he will. I have called home so many times that my husband can tell by the way I say, "Hello, sweetie, what make and model I hit." So, you know, I'm a little sick of that. So the last time I thought, well, I'm going to mix you up. I said, "Hello, darling." He said, "Who is it?" I said, "I've had a little accident at the corner of Post and Geary." And he said, "Post and Geary don't cross." I said, "They do now." You wouldn't believe the number of cars involved in that one. But they said I was the leader. How can you be the leader when you're backing up? And you know, it's gotten so bad at our house that now, every time I bring that car home, I have to fill out a questionnaire. And he grades me. And last week, I lost bathroom privileges. And it's hell walking that dog as an equal. You know, it's gotten so bad I have to explain everything. One day I came home, I had a little lipstick on a fender. I said it was nothing. One woman was so thrilled I missed her, she kissed the car. She nearly got up from behind while she was stooping over. Of course, you know, I never made it as a homemaker. I've really given up. It's a mess. But I know that, well, I had gotten all of my ideas about homemaking out of Mademoiselle magazine. You might as well read Cinderella. They aren't going to tell. They never mentioned garbage. Boy, does that junk pile up. Within a week, you won't have any drawer space left. You can refrigerate just so much of that stuff. You gotta save some place for your ironing. And the first time I looked at that kitchen floor, I couldn't believe it. Sections of it were moving. And I thought, what would I do to me if I were that filthy? So I cold creamed it. And I made one big mistake. I left the room. And he came home. Well, he must have hit it awful fast. You haven't seen winter sports. Nobody knows how many times he went around before he hit the wall. And when I say hit the wall, we took him out with a torch. He broke six legs. He was carrying the dog. So I shot the dog and I had a bead on him. But a neighbor dropped in. Damn busybody. She's so excitable. Well, it was her dog. You know, I'm sure it's the same with every newlywed couple. The boy and the girl expect far different things from marriage. I know what the girl expects. Hearts and flowers. Well, it was like that right up until we were leaving the church. And then I watched this man turn square. And by the time we get home, I know I'm in for a lecture by the way he says, baby. And, you know, he's coming on like James Cagney. Remember those old movies? I don't know why he was giving it this. He had forgotten his pants. Then when he said baby again, I realized he had forgotten my name. But he hadn't forgotten the lecture. He starts out, he says, look, I want you to be a little old-fashioned housewife, and we will start out by you dressing a chicken for Sunday dinner. He's got to be kidding. It took me 3 weeks to make the blouse. And he says, what's more, I want you to dress old-fashioned. I want you to wear those little chintzy aprons. He should have told me you're supposed to wear something under them. You think you've seen a frightened Fuller Brush man? He didn't even come back for his car. Without my clothes on, I look like a sack full of doorknobs. Do you realize that you are looking at a Slenderella reject? But oh boy, have I compensated. Every day I go to an indoor pool and I wear a bikini over an old raincoat. And I was at the pool today, as usual, and I was doing the Australian crawl for quite a while. And my husband comes over and says, you idiot. Get in the pool. I can't do it in the pool. And he knows it. You know, he's still coming on, like James Cagney. It's been years now. I've been analyzing it. Why? I think I got it figured. Men try forever to preserve the old football image. But, you know, it's so ridiculous with him. He's shaped like one. I lace him up every morning. Oh, and he's still talking about his injuries. He was hurt once in a huddle. And another time when the bench fell over backwards. But I have definitely beat the rap. I don't have to cook anymore. And tonight was the last, believe me. And I enjoy eating out. You can get stung now, don't get me wrong. I ordered a steak a couple of nights ago, rare. With a little care, this thing could have recovered. But I drank it. But I really do enjoy exotic foods. Well, the more expensive, the better. I love truffles. Ooh. I just told a big lie. They're very chic, let's put it like that, but they're rotten. And I went home and looked it up in the dictionary, and no wonder. It's a fungus. This stuff grows underground in France, and they can't do a thing to stop it. So what do? They dig it up and send it to us, and we're fools enough to eat it. And you know who digs it up for them? Pigs. And they won't touch the junk. Well, I guess that's what raises the price. But my favorite is sukiyaki. That's Italian. Oh, you're hip tonight. Well, you know, on the West Coast, they have these Japanese sukiyaki. How's that? They're just too, well, unsanitary. You eat it on the floor, they cook it on the floor, I stepped in it. And you haven't lived till you've had a fried rice hot foot. Of course, I admit, I had been in the bar since December. And there's one thing I've got to warn you about. They make you take your shoes off. Ready or not. Oh, well, I panicked. I had spent a couple of hours putting myself together. I'd spent $10 on my hair and spent a cent on my feet. And here they are asking me to take off my shoes. The last thing I thought anyone would ask me to take off. Oh, with any kind of luck. And I'm the only one who knows that I'm sitting there wearing 10 corn pads. Without my shoes on, I look like a typewriter. So I offered to take off anything else. Well, that brought the ugliest manager right through a shoji screen. He says, "Please, lady, people are eating." Turned out to be my old Fuller Brush man. It seems he has a photographic memory. He's still being treated for trauma. Serves him right. Oh, you wouldn't have believed the way the girl was dressed who was serving us. Not to be believed. She was very young. I didn't like her. She was such a doll, I kept looking for a key in her back. And she was dressed authentically to the floor. She had on clogs, which I thought were calluses. Until she stepped on my hand. Oh, you're at their mercy. You're on the floor. You're propped up by your hands. Your feet are straight out in front of you. And they have gone to sleep. Now remember, you're gonna need them later. And I swear the girls seem to get their kicks by walking on your hands. She had developed a little two-step, never missed me once. And if you rest a minute, they will walk on your chest. Now, it doesn't really hurt, but have you ever tried to explain a footprint on your chest? To the kids. Oh, and there's another thing I must warn you about. I don't know anybody in the world who can sit in that position for 2 hours and then get up and walk. You're gonna try. And you're gonna get a lot of laughs. Well, finally, they just turned me over. And I crawled to the car. Well, now, if you don't think that is embarrassing, I don't have too good a reputation to begin with. And I'll tell you, I didn't wave at anybody. I'll tell you how I played it. I barked all the way to cover. And then I thought, what the hell? I sat in the back seat and drooled and licked the window. And you know, it isn't a bad life. Except all next week, my husband kept hitting me with a folded newspaper. And I haven't been on the furniture since. Well, he gets so nasty during an obedience test. I got a leash burn you're not going to believe. Oh, but I fixed him today. I bit him. And I haven't had my shots. And I know I've got it. Oh, I gotta tell you about that girl, the cute one. You remember that young one with the student body? She had on the tightest kimono I have ever seen. Through. You could see her blood circulating. And I didn't like the route it was taking. You talk about tight. If she had a wart, her dressmaker fit it. And she had a couple of warts. And on top of that, she had this thing split to the navel, which she had had moved. Now, who would want their navel on their hip? Maybe you don't think it took me a while to figure that out. Here's the way I figure it. Plastic surgery is getting more and more popular, and I figure she went to a doctor for a face job, and he oversold her that. You know, and I just want to tell you, there's a sequel to that evening at the Sukiyaki house. It's not a pretty thing, and I'd like to bring it up. You see, when I got home, oh, I forgot to tell you, you know how it is when you get into one of these places where you're doing everything on the floor. You heard of hitting the bottle? Well, I was socking the socky. Well, it was my night off. And you know, when you're on the floor, you get the feeling so secure. Because you know you can't fall off of anything. Oh, and I got to the show off stage by dinner. I am going to show everybody, you know, Smartsville. Oh, yes. And I'm speaking Japanese to the girl. It was terrible. Oh, yes, one time she stepped on me, I said, "Kumbawa." That means my nose is running. I didn't know it, so she wiped my nose. That didn't look so good. And then I went way too far. I ate with the chopsticks. Forget it. I don't think they really meet. Once you've picked them up, you're committed. Unless you want to be known as a quitter the rest of your life. So I had to pick them up, and I didn't get a bite of food. I got a lot in my ears. I got a lot in my hair. In fact, I didn't hear half the conversation, but I looked good. And when I left, I am wearing this gorgeous fried rice jabot. Overnight, I put the dress in the freezer with my ironing. And the next day, I sent it to the cleaners, and the day after, I got it back with the ugliest little poison pen note you ever read in your life. They call it a sting ticket. Now, I wouldn't have read it, but I actually thought it was a mash note from their presser. Pinned right up here, and you couldn't miss it. Now, if you go down to the hotel with this on, you're going to get in with a convention. So you have to take it off. Dreadful, ugly little note from my cleaner. Starts out, "Dear sloppy eater, every possible effort has been made." Now, who believes that? Now, you know darn well they didn't sand it. And up in the corner of the stain ticket is a picture of these little teeny people working on my dress. Why don't they hire full-size help? That would help, don't you think? And another thing, you know what I think? I picture it this way. What do you want to bet? They're down at the plant all high on cleaning fluid. You know, those plants are windowless. And they're so busy writing the ugly little letters. Oh, I admit the dress was in rotten shape. I had dropped it a couple of times on the way home. No, I was in it. Otherwise, it wouldn't have rolled so far. You wouldn't believe what it picked up. 3 gum wrappers and a sailor. I didn't even know we were at war. When you hear the rest of it, it gets worse. Every possible effort has been made to remove all the stains from his garment. However, those remaining cannot be removed, in our judgment, without injury to the fabric and the morale of our entire plant. And the stain ticket isn't even clean. Now, here's what I want to get across to you, and you get one of these, and you will. If you're having any fun at all, you're going to get one. I frankly think cleaners are against everything. When you get one of these, don't read it. It will bring you way down. I don't care how happy you were when you got out of bed. Oh, this wrecked my day. I had gotten out of bed on the wrong side. And it's dangerous for me. It's against the wall. And right away, that puts me in the driveway. In my footsie pajamas. With my security blanket. I've got one that plugs in. It's electric. One night I was so depressed, I turned it clear up to 104. I don't get like that anymore. I've been analyzed, you know. Oh, you can tell. My analyst is so great, he cured me of everything that wasn't paying off. So now I'm still sick, but I'm rich. You know, you have a right to be insecure, and you don't need to take the blame yourself. It's your parents' fault. Muzzy and dadsy duty. And may I tell you what happened to me? When I was 3 years old, my folks sent me out to buy bubble gum. And while I was out, they moved.